Yeah. Okay. Hey, it's Benjamin Ray here, and I'm with Allard today. He's a CEO and he's a green tech entrepreneur. How are you today?
Yes. Hi. Good. What is it? Good afternoon. Good morning. where you are? I'm a bit confused. What time zone you're operating in?
So I'm in Mountain Standard Time, and you are now in Malaysia.
I'm in Malaysia. It's something like 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning here.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I appreciate you coming here. Can you tell a little bit about your path and how you got to this place and really what initiatives you're working on now?
As I told you, I live in Malaysia. I'm a Dutchman of origin. I lived all over the world, basically because my career in retail sent me there. And so I was headhunted eventually to be a CEO of a retailer here in Malaysia. And after doing that for 5 years, I had the opportunity to start my own business in consulting, which went very well. Sold that a year ago. And that was like a moment where I decided, you know, I had my career, I had also done well financially out of the business that I started here, that I felt it was time to give back. And so to reinvest that money in a way for something I was really passionate about and which would actually, you know, give back to the community and to the country where I'm operating right now and to the region. So that's why I decided to invest in Free the Seed, which was, they were at that moment already operating for a number of years. But the issue that we have is basically one of capital. And so my contribution partly has contributed to actually be able to start producing more. And that's what we're doing now. So we are producing 5-6 containers per month of our product. But the demand is far exceeding that. We could be selling, well, potentially, we don't even try to sell more. But if we wanted, we could sell like up to 100 times more than what we're selling now.
So when you're talking about containers, can you explain the process then and really what Free the Seed is? I mean, it's such a cool name. You know, I saw the video and I was like, wow, this is such a great idea. Got to get a hold of you. So if you could explain that, really, the process, it's really amazing in terms of sustainability.
Yeah. So first of all, so we are located in the middle of the paddy fields and the rice fields in the northern part of Malaysia. And so what we do is that we collect the paddy straw from the rice fields. So after harvest, the paddy straw is basically left on the land because the straw does not have any proteins in it. It does not have any nutrients that are particularly good for animal feed. So you can give it to animals and they might eat it. But actually, you know, after a while they will stop eating it because it doesn't have protein. So cows, etc., are not interested in it. So what the farmers do is they simply set it on fire. And so what you have in the region is that during the dry season, you have the infamous haze. The biggest and most spectacular cause is actually the burning of peat. So after jungle is cleared, the peat is left, and that is then set on fire, and that very often gets out of control. And that is really when the international, you know, the world takes notice of this problem. But actually in Malaysia, most of the haze is actually caused by simply farmers burning rice straw and not so much the clearing of jungles anymore. So when we talk about how bad it is that the agricultural waste is burned, for the local population, the CO2 emissions is not really the biggest problem. It's actually the haze. It is simply at the start of the dry season in September that it gets very, very foggy and dark, and that is not good. So that is the first problem that you have. The other thing, so what we collect the rice straw and we pay the farmers for it, and that is another important part. Malaysia has, as many other countries in the region, but Malaysia and Indonesia are in that sense the worst, is that they have really bet on big crops like palm oil, and actual agriculture for food is not very is insufficiently done. So Malaysia actually has to import most of its own food supply and even rice. So it is important to be able to help the rice farmers to get some extra income. So we bring that to our factory. It's important that the plant is very close to the paddy fields. So we're really in the middle of the paddy fields, because the as you can imagine, the rice straw is very bulky. And then we pulp it. And in that, we have a process that is our intellectual property. We use the enzymes of papaya to break down the fibers and convert it into pulp. In that process, we lose a lot of the volume. So it is like 1/7 of the total volume that it is. So it's really important that first process, because the logistic cost of the rice straw is, of course, is the largest part, is just bringing it around, so it's so bulky. And then we have that pulp. We have currently the pulping plant right next to it. We have 6 production lines. Those are machines that we bought in Korea. They are especially made for our factory. And there we convert that pulp we make out of it, biodegradable packaging. Many things can be made of it, and so our customers, this is custom made for our customers, but most what we do now are like trays for retailers, so like fruit trays, you know, apples, and the mold is especially in the form of the fruits that the retailers sell. But we also work for hospitals, so bed pans, kidney trays, products like that. A huge demand at this moment, because it is really, though, you know, it is advised that everything is single use now. So because of COVID-19, demand has exploded for that. But that isn't very often plastic. We make it out of our product, and our product is, well, we call it biodegradable, but in reality, it is better than that. Our product has absolutely no glue or plastics in it. So it is compostable, and it just goes back to compost after use.
It's a great idea, really. I mean, and I'm surprised that more people don't know about it or using what you're doing. So if you you're kind of in a capital funding phase here, what would you do with that money? Is it more machinery? Is it awareness? Is it trying to, tell me about that.
Well, at this moment, awareness comes. I mean, I don't know how hard it is, because I haven't really, since I'm involved, I didn't really try to sell more. We have 2 contracts of customers, and they could easily buy, let's say, 10 times more or something like that. So we would simply buy more machinery. We have on the, where we are located now, we could basically put 10 times more production lines that we currently have, and that would only be for our current customers. The best thing, and eventually what needs to happen, is that, let's say, companies like Nestle or Unilever or Procter & Gamble, they would like to work with us, but they demand much higher volume of product. You know, they, for them, it is, for them to switch to our product, they need a guaranteed production, which is much higher than what we're capable. So what actually needs to be done is we just have to expand. We have a contract for 10 years to buy the paddy straw from the farmers. We are buying only 1-2% of that in the region in northern Malaysia where we are. But basically this process can be done with wherever rice production is happening, and it can even be done with other products. I mean, we want to stay only with agricultural waste. We never want to use, for example, wheat straw, because then we would lose our circular economy advantage, because wheat straw can be used for animal feed. But we have tried the process also on other forms of agricultural waste, and that it can be used for that as well.
So when you have your one central facility, will you need to make numerous ones of those, or are you able to buy, transport, produce, and then export it out of there?
So currently what we do is we basically, everything that we produce at this moment is exported to Europe. And it goes, we're relatively close to the port of Penang, and it just goes on containers, most of it goes to Rotterdam, some of it goes to Australia. We have all, so far we have not been producing for the local market, but we are now discussing with the local supermarket, which is like more upmarket. So we are in a position that we could be also start producing for the local market. But we are also, for example, in discussion with Saudi Arabia, where they want to use it for the Hajj, for the annual pilgrimage in Saudi Arabia and in Mecca, because there they use 1 billion styrofoam or plastic cups. Wow. To drink the holy water. Wow. 1 billion, and it is just chucked away. It's actually an embarrassment for the Muslim world, and they would love to work with us as well. But again, the just the sheer amount of product that is needed is just hard to hard for us to manage.
What is the time scale? You know, how does it work, you know, when you from start to finish with a farmer to getting a product out?
Relatively fast. So basically from the moment that we pick up the rice straw to having a kidney tray or a bed pan is like 3 days, and it's done. Of course, the rice straw has to be dry. We pick it up and it's popped, and it can go almost immediately to production.
Wow. So the types of containers, can you go into all the different ones that you are currently making? Specifically, and then how you see that growing in the future with new lines, new products.
Yeah, well, look, we have the capability to produce more specific products than what we're doing now. So things like bed pans, kidney trays, and the trays for retail are relatively non-specific. But we have the capability to produce also for technical industries like LED lamps, etc., which need a very precise molding, and that would be higher margin, and that is something that we're interested in, because we could do with a little bit more margin than what we have. So, but all this is basically a matter of product development, and it can be done. So that is where we would like to move with our current facilities. The new machinery that we're buying is a little bit less, can allows us to produce a little bit more, but would not have that technical capability. So we could use that for our current, for let's say what we're producing now. We could start. In the new factory, we're going to use slightly, you know, less high spec machines, so that the current machinery can be used for the very high spec work where we have better margins.
So why do you think that there aren't more companies that are doing things like you're doing? You know, why are the big companies still using the single use styrofoam?
Yeah, the reason is, I think for one of the reasons is that most of the companies that have our technology and are located in places where it can be made don't have the financial resources. A company like ours, if we would be, you know, a London company or something like that, we would be easily getting the capital required, but in Malaysia that is a little bit harder. So that is a problem which some of those bigger companies understand, and they are now putting money apart. I mean, they don't want to be involved in production of packaging that is not there. That's not why the shareholders buy shares in Procter & Gamble, but they are now like having like funds that would support companies like ours, and you see that coming. Especially, it's European companies leading the way, because they are in the biggest hurry because of EU regulation. That basically many European companies have like 2-3 years to change their the way that they're operating and to phase out single plastic use. And it is basically those companies that are most interested in helping companies like ours to enhance our productivity.
I was on a call yesterday with a woman from Canada, and she was talking about that's going to happen in the next 10 years in Canada, and you're seeing it sooner happen in the EU. And I'm wondering, are the companies being proactive and really making those strides now, or are they just waiting till the last minute to switch over?
I find it at this moment that they are kind of hiding behind the fact that it, you know, it's like, well, we, you know, as long as it's difficult to source, they're all in the same boat. They know that, you know, that it, that is an argument that they are probably using internally as well. And so it's hard. And I mean, we would if we could. So basically, for me, the message is that it is actually possible, because the amount of simply agricultural waste that's around is more than enough to ramp up our production enormously. So there's actually no excuse. And that is probably the message that needs to go out, you know, by simply saying, yeah, it's possible, and it is just a matter of investing in companies like ours.
And where would that leadership come from within the country, within the companies, to make those decisions? Is it corporate social responsibility? Is it top down? Is it innovations within each company? Where do you see that coming from?
So what I'm trying to do now is go to those type of companies together with an investor that has the money, is willing to put their money in. So basically get three people at the table at the same time. That is us, that is the Unilevers of this world, and an investor which has the outside money. And I do think that it is top down, because when you go to the more corporate responsibility kind of people, they are not the ones that can take that big decisions. It is a bit, it is when you talk to the packaging people, they have their agenda and their sourcing requirements, which say, no, sorry, you need 100 production lines before we can even talk to you. So I guess that basically it will be eventually knocking on, at the very, very highest level to have that discussion.
Wow. I mean, it's super interesting. What about price? So, we've had a lot of discussions here about price. Will it cost more? Do your packages cost more? Now, I understand there's a whole, argument for supply chain and reducing waste, but how about your packages? How do those factor into it when you get that question?
Well, what I can say is that, so in order to gain a bit of traction, our founder CEO, a biologist who started this process and who doesn't have a lot of commercial experience, he basically positioned the price against the same product but then plastic. Mm-hmm. So we have been selling roughly at that same price. Now, one of the things that I advised to do and that we're doing now is raise our prices, and absolutely no resistance from our customers at all. So we, he just said, what about 20% more? And they said, well, produce, it doesn't matter, I don't care. So we haven't really tested the price elasticity there at this moment. So let's say we are now, we asked for 20% more, we got it. So basically we're 20% above the plastic alternatives, and that is not yet the resistance point. We haven't reached that yet.
Well, that's great. Great, you can get that. I'm finding on the consumer side, consumers don't want to pay that extra cost. So as long as that extra cost isn't just passed on, and it's really the company's leading, saying this is good for us. It's not just good for, PR. It's great for the world and it's good for our bottom line overall. Those companies are going to lead the way in this over the next 5 to 10 years.
Yeah, it is unfortunate for you. I mean, I just feel that we have not yet really... we don't really know yet where we can go in that sense, because it was so hard for Malaysia to get to start, because here in Malaysia there is not enough awareness of the need to make that change. Before I came on board, when we started to sell, it was really saying, well, I could, please buy from me and it costs the same. But that was not, clearly that was not profitable. And so it is, when I hear those discussions more in the Western world, I hear a lot about price and, that we're not willing to pay that. I would say, let's see. I don't really think that our process is so much more expensive, to be honest. The only thing is that, you still have to bring it in from Malaysia. Ideally, we would be selling in closer to home. And for, you know, all that is needed is that the awareness and also the regulation changes within Southeast Asia. But ideally, this is something that you can do with agricultural waste there where production is. So one of the things that what I would like to do, I own a house in southern France surrounded by wine, by vineyards. And our product is excellent for transporting bottles because it is more shock absorbent than plastic and now very often, you know, you have kind of fancy wooden crate or things like that. We can actually, from the cuttings of the vines, we can do this process as well. So ideally, our plant would be there where the wine production is, and you would actually buy your wine packaged in made out of the agricultural waste of wine itself.
Wow. I mean that's reducing waste 100%, and that's an amazing idea. Let's go.
Wouldn't you spend two or three, a few cents a dollar on your wine? It is. I think that wine drinkers would have no problem with that at all.
I agree with that. So let's go forward 10 years, and let's say, you know, where is your company, and where's the rest of the world in terms of being able to use your products or products like these?
Yeah. Well, look, for where the world is headed to, this market is so huge that there is space for everyone. So I would say that this type of solutions, we are not looking for world domination. We just want to be a part of the solution. So where we would be, well, we understand that most likely we will be working with partners. Very often you would have some sort of government involvement because you need to buy the from the farmers. Very often in the region, the government would like to, because they're very often subsidizing those farmers already. So you probably need government relations and you would probably need local partners for each of those for those initiatives. So where I see us heading is in Malaysia, we could easily expand many times from what we are now, and I would ideally see us setting up partnerships in rice producing countries across the region, and there are many countries where the it would be even more beneficial for the farmers than it is in Malaysia, where more people depend on rice for as rice farmers for their living, like Vietnam, Myanmar, etc. So we would really like to partner up in the region, and potentially if I one day might return to Europe or California, it would be great to work, with those crops where our process works as well.
And why is that Europe is leading this over the United States? Why is Europe ahead in the awareness for this?
I don't know if it's awareness. I think that political will has been lacking a bit. Political leadership has been lacking a bit. Let's see. I think that there is in Europe, I think there's some acceptance that the EU, from a kind of a bureaucratic point of view, leads the charge and those things, and there is not much resistance to that. In the US, I mean, it's hard to know, because if there is basically no one in Europe who really stood up and said, we want to get out of the Paris Accords, or we want to, we don't. It's not a thing really to resist that, as far as I know. How many people, whether the awareness really is that much different, I don't know. There's just no political culture of opposing this type of regulation. That is the way I would call it.
It's good. So, how can people get a hold of you? What's the website? What's the best way to contact you? Is it through direct message? Is it through email?
You could send me an email, but then you have to. Then I have to pronounce my last name, and that's going to put that many people off.
I know we bypassed that part today.
So I would, for that reason, I would say DM me on just on LinkedIn. That's fine. Also, there is a link to our website, which is freetheseed.com.my. And there in the contact, the contact section, you would also can just click on it and the email comes to me as well.
That's great. Well, I wish you a lot of luck and it's super exciting. I'll be monitoring to see how you go over the years. So thanks for coming on the show.
Wonderful. Well, thanks for having me. For me, it's a great opportunity to discuss this with the wider world. And thank you for giving me that opportunity.
You bet. All right. You have a great day.
All right. I'm going to sleep now.
Okay. All right. See you later.
Bye.